History's been leaning on me lately. I can feel the future breathing down my neck. And all the things I thought were true when I was young and you were too, turns out to be broken. And I don't know what comes next. In a world that has decided that it's going to lose its mind, be more kind, my friends. Try to be more kind. Talking to each other, and there's something wrong with that. So before you go out searching, don't decide what you will find. Be more kind, my friends. Try to be more kind. You should know. Both of us to sand and sea, and where the dry land stands is hard to say. And as the current drags us by the shore, we can no longer say for sure who's drowning and if they can be saved. You're out there floundering like a lighthouse, we will shine. Be more kind, my friends. Try to be more kind. Like a beacon reaching out to you and yours for me and mine. Be more kind, my friend. Try to be more kind. That it's going to lose its mind. Be more kind, my friends. Try to be more kind.
Good morning, how are you?
Thank you.
I invite you to stand and sing as we get started this morning. Welcome to worship. Join with me.
For 4,000 tongues to see my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all
Stream and wherever else you watch us later. A couple of announcements before we begin. First, if you would, I'd like to honor your attendance with us this morning. And if you're in the room, there should be a Connect card near you, and either at the end of your row or a seat in front of you. They're the cards that at one point stood straight up, and then the humidity in the room allowed them to bow down in servitude to us. So look for one of those. Also, if in the basket by the pillar back there is our offering basket. So at some point in the service, if you'd like to leave an offering to support our ministries, you're welcome to do that as well. As for announcements, on Sunday, June 19th, our Next Gen families, that's our children and youth ministries, are invited to a beach in Rolla, Missouri from 3 to 5 called Fugitive Beach. And no, it is not a place where fugitives run to. I have no idea why it's called Fugitive Beach, but maybe you can look that up and tell me later. But anyway, we will be there from 3 to 5 playing in the water. More details and directions and all and sign-up information can be found on the app under upcoming events. July 4th is soon to be upon us, and as you know, downtown Jefferson City gets a little backlogged around that weekend and sometimes a little difficult to get to. And so we will not have worship service here on July 3rd in the building at all on Saturday night or Sunday morning. We will have one service on July 3rd at 10 a.m. at noon at the North JC Rec area. It's the park, you guessed it, to the north by the airport. And so we will provide drinks, hamburgers, hot dogs. You're welcome to bring a side dish. And so after the service, we will just have a picnic together and celebrate and play around in the park together. So join us then Sunday, July 3rd. And lastly, the Heart of a Champion Sports Camp is coming up a week from Monday. That's when it's supposed to start for kids that have finished kindergarten and those that have finished fifth grade. And that'll happen 5:30 to 8 p.m. And it is a four-day sports-themed camp where the kids will play football, soccer, and basketball, and learn how these sports can help us grow closer to God, and learn why soccer is the best sport. That's the subtext with that. All right? So as you're able, will you stand and join us in our welcoming liturgy? And say this together. We gather as one body because God calls us to community. We gather as one body because we need each other. We gather as one body to worship the God who makes us one. Let us sing.
Perpetually, every day, every moment, every breath, every heartbeat, to be aware of love everywhere. Everywhere, to be aware of love everywhere. victory. Open my eyes to see the beauty surrounding me. Open my ears to hear the song in the air. Open my heart to know the longing perpetually every day, every moment. In every breath, every heartbeat, to be aware of love everywhere, to be aware of love everywhere, to be aware of love everywhere. Awaken me into a dream.
Come together on a day that we call Pentecost, day in which we commemorate your spirits resting upon the disciples, giving them the ability to speak languages foreign to them. Also giving them a call to recognize your gospel is to spread throughout the world. That no living human being is too far gone. No living human being, no matter what trajectory or past they hold, they have a future in you. So God, on this day, we commemorate your spirit and we invite you to make a fresh wind upon us. That your spirit might move through us, not only as individuals, but as a country. A country mourning the death of far too many people by gun violence. Sad, it's heart, you know, it's heart-wrenching. It's evil played out in real form. God, I pray that you would give us the motivation. You give us the audacity to change, to be different, to not stand in its wake and pretend as though it's a normal day. So we ask your spirit to tear our hearts out again, to help us to see victims not just as some foreign, strange people, but as people that you have created. Fellow image bearers whose spark has gone too soon. Lord, may you move in us as you did in the disciples. May your spirit transform us. Change us to become more like you. So God, I pray that for a moment we might be able to lay aside whatever agendas, to-do lists, whatever anxieties await us outside of this room. Lay it aside for just a moment to be in tune with that same spirit so that you might be further able to transform us, to change our minds, to open our eyes and open our ears, give us hearts of compassion, soften our souls, and to be more ready and able to love. So God, as your people gathered here today, let us share in the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, any children in the room are welcome to go up to Sunday school. There should be Veronica or Kyrell right there by the door. There's Veronica. You just say her name and she appears. It's fantastic. So our children are going to head up to Sunday school. And as always, parents, if you would like to see the space where your children are going, you are more than welcomed and encouraged to go check it out just to see it and make sure it's where you want your children to be. With that, I would like to read from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 14. It says, when he noticed how the guests had picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, give this person your seat. Then humiliated, you will have to take the seat least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when the host comes, he might say to you, friend, move up to a better place. Then you will be honored in the presence of the other guests. For all these, those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Amen.
New sermon series this week. We'll go through the month of June called We Is Greater Than Me. And as I was been picking out songs for it and stuff, and I had this thought that I wanted to share. And in that, I was listening to some of these songs, and they're kind of like, everybody share stuff, and you know, be giving. And I was like, in today's atmosphere where things seem to be very like politically charged, I was afraid of us missing the point of some of these songs. Like this song here is. A song called Better People, and it has this line in it, we all have opinions, some of them get through, but there's better people with more good to do. And oftentimes we I find that people will jump to the highest levels of structure in representing their ideals. They say, well, I represent, I'm this political party or this one, and we forget to have a conversation about what we can do locally that doesn't, like, when I think about political parties, I don't think Jesus would have liked any of them, honestly. I think he would think that we waste a lot of time talking about things that happen thousands of miles away and not paying enough attention to what's happening on, you know, right in our own neighborhoods. And so that would be my challenge as we spend this month in worship together looking at that is, don't let this become a political ideology conversation. Let this become a conversation about what we are doing in our neighborhoods, in our communities, in our church, that is far more powerful than what we box we check come voting time. So, off my soapbox. This is Better People by a guy named Xavier Rudd. People save in Wales and giving thanks to our seas. My respect to the ones in the forest standing up for our old trees. Give them food for the hungry, hope to the needy, giving life to a baby, giving care for free, cause there's freedom around us. Everything we need, and I will care for you, cause you care for me, and we all have opinions. Some of them get through, but there's better people with more good to do, good to do, good to do. What I have could be a message, or just some words from my heart. My respect to the ones making changes for all the lives they give their all. Give them food for the hungry, hope to the needy, giving life to a baby, giving care for free, cause there's freedom around us. Everything we need, and I will care for you, cause you for me, and we all have opinions, and some of them get through, but there's better people with more good to do, good to do, good to do. When our world keeps spinning round and round it goes, Mother Nature keeps spreading its disease, and our children keep with what they know through what we teach and what they see. So the only question is of the time we have and the lives that our children lead, as they only keep growing up with what they know through what we teach and what they see. Give them food for the hungry, hope to the needy, give them life to the baby, give them there's freedom around us. Everything we need, and I will care for you, cause you care for me, and we all have opinions. Some of them get through, but there's better people with more good to do, good to do, good to do, good to do.
And thank you. This idea of we is greater than me, there's a couple of ways we could take it. One is rather, I think, simple, maybe. That may not be the right word, but on surface level, we'll say. And that is that our collective gifts, passions, talents, whatever we bring to the table, works better in concert together than it does individual. Right? I mean, think of like New York Symphony And all it is I gotta be careful what instrument to pick here. One drummer. I'm a drummer, so I'm a has-been drummer, so I can say that, right? It's fine and dandy and marvelous skill, but it's infinitely better when the whole orchestra brings into it, and then it becomes fully alive, right? I mean, that's kind of the basic sense. And nobody's going to stand up and say, no, me is better than we, right? Nobody in good conscience is going to say that. They might think it, but nobody's going to stand up and say it, because then it just immediately diminishes others around them. You know what I mean? So, like, that's surface level, we is greater than me. But I want to go a little deeper, and that is this, that, and this has both been scientifically proven and just sort of how we feel about it one another, but, like, as more devices enter our lives, the more connected we all become, it seems that the more isolated we feel, right? Like, we have more access to information in a week's time than people that lived 100 years ago had in their whole lifetime. Do you know that? Right? I mean, has any of you ever been in a waiting room, like at a doctor's office or a mechanic shop or whatever, and there's like 18 people in the room and every single person is on the phone, right? Well, why I do that is partly I'm somewhat engaged with what's on my phone, but then I know that if I'm engaged with my phone, then I'm less obligated to talk to people around me, right? Anybody been there? Cool, just me. All right, thanks, guys. Feel it? Feel the love? Right? And so, like, the more isolated we become, the more transactional we become in our relationships. Meaning the people that interact in your life are there because you need them for a moment. There's a transaction that takes place. Right, like, think of the cashier at the grocery store. The only reason you, most of us at least, ever interact with them is because you need them to leave the store legally. Right? And maybe not even then. With self-checkout, you can do it real quick as long as people know how to operate it swiftly. Right? I mean, you can get in and out of there. And delivery drivers, at one point, the same delivery drivers had the same routes, and you would see the same person time and again, and today they're mostly operated by algorithms that tell you where you have to stop and what is the most efficient route to get there, which means sometimes you don't even have the same delivery person to drop Amazon packages off on your doorstep. Isn't that crazy? So people in our lives have become more isolated, we become more transactional in our relationships, and more siloed than we've ever been before. The idea of, and this is partly why it's so refreshing to have friends that you just hang out with. Like those rare nights that happen, you know, twice a decade, where you invite people over and you just like chill and have dinner and watch a movie with friends, and there's no transactional value in this. There's nothing we're getting out of it other than just being together. You know what I mean? Those are precious, heartfelt moments because they become rare. I remember growing up, my dad had Tuesdays off. And he would often take me to school, and one of the places we would go before we went to school was Donut House. And I may have romanticized this memory just a small amount, I'm sure of it, but the donuts were huge and tasty. I mean, they were the best donuts in the world. I still believe that, even though I'm sure I romanticized it. But still, they were really great. And what I remember is not just the donuts and spending time with my dad, but I remember In the corner, inevitably, every Tuesday, there was a group of guys that would just be there chatting, drinking coffee, and eating donuts together. And when I was little, I thought, oh, that's so awesome. They decide to do that on Tuesdays, too. And then my dad probably told me, well, they probably do this every day. But I love it, thinking about it, you know, in my adult life, reflecting on that moment, thinking about these guys don't have any transactional value with one another. They're just being together as human beings. I'm sure they're griping about something, right? As any group of guys gets together in a coffee shop does. Believe me, I know it, right? But there's something valuable about just being together for the sole purpose of just being together that allows us to become fully alive, to remember that we're human, and remember that we're worth more than just what we can get out of one another. And that is, I think, really what it means that to be we is greater than me. That how can I enter into relationships with people around me in a way that allows me and for them to become fully alive? And God designed us this way to need one another. And if you look through the Bible, both the Old Testament and New Testament, the way God interacts with people is almost exclusively in a group context. Think of it this way. When Moses gave the Ten Commandments, he gave it to Moses. Moses comes down the mountain and he delivers them to the people, not necessarily individuals. When the prophets were sent to restore right order of worship and right sense of community, the people that had gone astray from the will of God, the prophets weren't sent to individual households. They were sent to whole communities or regions sometimes. Noah, whenever he built the ark to save all the animals on the planet and all human civilization, it wasn't just to save a specific family, it was to save the humanity, the human group of people. When the prophet Samuel was there and witnessed how God had saved the Israelites miraculously from the Philistines, and he set up this big stone and he called it Ebenezer to remind the people how God was faithful to the people, not necessarily to individuals. And at Pentecost, whenever the disciples were gathered around in the upper room and the Spirit had washed through them and it said tongues of fire rested upon their heads, and then they were sent out away, out into the people, not necessarily to individuals. The story of God is overwhelmingly about how God interacts with people as a collective and not as individuals. In fact, the most famous Bible verse of all time is in John 3:16 that says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." And then for some reason, it doesn't ever make the bumper sticker. The more important verse, in my opinion, is verse 17 that comes afterward. "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him, to save the group of humanity, the people, not just individuals." So it's overwhelming. The gospel of Jesus Christ is exclusively focused on the we. And this may jar some of you, and I don't mean it to, but it did me at one point in my life. But the phrase personal Lord and Savior doesn't appear in Scripture. It's just not there. It doesn't mean that we don't have a personal relationship with God. It doesn't mean that we don't work on our own personal discipleship. And it doesn't necessarily mean that we don't have a personal relationship with God. But the more emphasis we put on this phrase, personal Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, then it's far too easy to go down the slide where we believe the gospel of Jesus Christ becomes about, you guessed it, me. About the individual me rather than the collective we that the gospel is actually more concerned about. And I remind you, the crux of the gospel is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Without it, the rest of it doesn't really make sense. The rest of it just makes Jesus just a really good teacher, not the Savior of the world. In Matthew 16, Jesus says this, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." That's the gospel. To follow is to lose your life. To not hold on to this desperate me as though it's the only thing giving you life. John 15 writes, "Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends." Or even more radical, in Matthew 5, this is a Sermon on the Mount. Jesus is gathered with all these hodgepodge of people from around the communities. Largely, they're lame, they're sick, they're poor, they're just looking for hope. And Jesus tells them this. He says, "You've heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other one. And if anyone wants to sue you and to take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go 2 with them. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you." Now that's radical nonsense, isn't it? If somebody wants to sue you and take everything, the gospel calls you to hand over things they forgot. Right? I mean, there's this old myth. I'm sure it's not a historical story, but it's still like it embellishes this well. That there's a story of a monk that had taken a vow of poverty, and all he had in his little bedchambers was 2 sets of clothing. And so he was out in the monastery doing yard work, and a thief comes in, goes into his room, opens up his wardrobe, takes his 2 pieces of clothing, stuffs them under his arm, and then starts to run out of the monastery. And the monk witnesses this from down below, and he runs upstairs to his room to see what the thief had stolen. And he opens up his wardrobe, sees that all that's gone, and then he turns and he sees that stuck between the mattress and the wall was a pair of socks. And so he grabs the pair of socks and he runs after the thief, and he sees him just a little bit down the road, and he yells as loud as he can, "You forgot something!" That's the kind of gospel Jesus calls us to. It's radical. It's nonsensical at times. And it's forever not about you. And it won't ever be. To help us, the followers, make sense of this, in Luke 15, our passage from today, Jesus and his disciples are eating at a Pharisee's house. In the Greco-Roman world, your social standing meant everything. You had to climb the social ladder, and the way you did that is be around really wealthy, popular, influential people. It's a good thing we've moved on from that. And in the Greco-Roman world, the more popular people you sat next to, you believed it made you more popular. And in this case, the more closer you sat to the host, the more likely you were to gain social capital that you could cash in later. And so all the disciples and other followers of Jesus were vying for the most popular seat next to the host, to the Pharisee. And then Jesus, as he does so well, he takes social norms and he flips it on its head and he tells them this parable. It says, at a wedding banquet, don't take a seat of honor because a more honest guest might arrive. And actually it says someone more distinguished than you might arrive, and the host will come to you and say, hey, you, get out of that seat, go take a lower seat. And then you'll be humiliated in front of everybody. He says, but instead, and this is the stuff that would make no sense in the Greco-Roman world at all, instead, take the lowest seat possible so that maybe the host might come to you and elevate you to a more honored seat. And then you can have more prestige. And then he drops this bombshell in 14:11, which is kind of the whole crux of what he's saying this for. It says, for all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Then he takes it a little step further. It says, don't invite friends or family or rich neighbors to your shindig. The scripture doesn't say shindig. That's Trevor's paraphrase. So don't invite them to your shindig because they will repay you. Don't do that so that they will repay you, because then it's ultimately self-serving. He says, instead, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, all that will be blessed, those that are ostracized in his community, those that nobody else wants. He says, if you're a follower of Jesus, that's who you should actually invite. And the reason is because when we do that, we dive deeper into a different level of community than what most of us have experienced. You dive into that lower, that deeper level of community, and suddenly you realize you're blessing people that have no capacity to ever pay you back. And that you are only doing that because you love them. Remind you, at one point Jesus was asked, what's the greatest commandment of all? And it's supposed to be a trap, and of course, you don't write a good novel where the main character gets trapped. And Jesus says this. He says, the first is, hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. That's the Jewish Shema would have been one of the first verses Jewish children would have ever memorized, even still today. It'd be written on signposts. It would have been everywhere. And then he takes it a step further. He says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. That's everything that makes us human. Our spiritual side, our physical side, everything that we are as human being, we are to love God. And we are to become fully alive in that. And that's the kind of love that God has for us whenever we are able to become fully alive, not just worried about our social capital among one another, not among the things that we believe are successful, but whenever we are really, truly alive, when we are less transactional in our relationships, whenever we really dive deep into seeking to be in relationship with those that don't have the capacity to pay us back. It's then that we become our truest, fullest self. And then Jesus goes one step further, and he says, the second is, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. That same love that you feel, and that whenever those moments where you feel like God loves you and you become fully alive, he says, that same kind of breath, that same spirit, that same kind of oomph is what you are to love your neighbors with. And the more isolated we are, the more transactional we are, the less we are able to do that. The more people around us become like wallpaper or obstacles. And the more people are like obstacles or wallpaper to you, then the more your own individual needs become more important than the collective good. And it creates this cycle that we live into over and over and over again. And the results are we become more polarized, or it becomes more dangerous to say anything, or it becomes more difficult to engage in dialogue with people that are different than you, to think differently. We cut each other off short. We fail to use imagination and give people the benefit of the doubt. It's a dangerous place to be, and it's where we find ourselves. But as Christian people, our job is to remember that we is far greater than me. And again, nobody's going to stand up and say, no, you're wrong. Me is infinitely greater than we, right? I mean, it's a paradox of sorts, because in America, we live in a great country that allows us to have incredible freedom. Have you ever thought about this? Like, we have incredible freedom that we get to celebrate, and our Constitution is written in such a way that we are to be concretized in our individual freedoms just to a level to where we're almost godlike, but not quite, just one bar short of it. Right? Like, think of it this way. You can walk into a grocery store, and you can be the kindest, most generous, loving person there is to everybody around you. And you are perfectly within the law. Or you could go into that same grocery store, take the same route, pick up the same items, and be a total and absolute jerk to everybody. You're not going to have any friends at the end of it, but you can. You can just say mean things to people. You can just walk around, do what you want, and you are still within the law. It's incredible freedom. So the question is, how do we reconcile living in a culture that glamorizes, concretizes, whatever, makes really important our individual civil liberties, and yet we worship a faith that invites us to pick up our cross daily and to deny ourselves for the greater good? And the way we do that is to keep in mind that we is infinitely greater than me. So what do we take with all this? Here's what I'm going to leave you with. One is, all of us, including myself, we have to take the giant humble pill. Just every day. Just that's your prescription. Take a big old humble pill, and to know that nothing in your life is ever about you. I know it's like startling revelation, but it's true. We have to take the humble pill every day. And remember that the gospel of Jesus Christ is also not about you. Otherwise, it would be called the gospel of Trevor Dancer. And that would be a terrible gospel. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ, the one who gives life, the one who invites us, invigorates us in our heart, our mind, our soul, and our strength, so that we become fully alive human individuals and not just our selves to manufacture the best transaction we can among one another, but to live our lives to the fullest. Take the humble pill every day, and remember, it's not about you. The second is this: make room in your life for those that don't have the capacity to pay you back in any kind. I remember, this is several months ago now, but I remember at our library, there's a little shelf just on the outside of the building for some reason, decorative architectural reasons, I guess, but some of our unsheltered individuals will hang out there at the library, and they'll come take a shower, grab some lunch, whatever, and just hang out there. And I've always kind of just, you know, it raises all sorts of questions, and it has raised some problems before, but whatever. I remember a couple of months ago, there was a woman that was going into the library, and she observed all these folks just hanging out on the shelf, and then she did something that I thought was just really cool. She came back the next day, and she didn't bring, like, a lunch or anything with her. She didn't, nothing transactional, nothing like, I'm going to come and save you, right? It was, she came, and she sat on the shelf with them and read a book. That's all she did. And it was an amazing thing for me. And I don't know her motivations. I don't know who she was. I haven't seen her since. I don't know. She may have had a terrible time. She may have just been sitting there grumbling. I don't know. But in my head, I thought, this is cool. Somebody is going to just be with people that often feel invisible. And that's the gospel. She made room in her life, even for just a moment, for people that don't have the capacity to pay her back. And that's what the gospel that calls us to. And the last is this. All of this, the understanding of we is greater than me, all of it is meant to anchor us together in a deeper community level than we have before. All of it is meant to be a binding glue to help us remember that each and every single one of us, that we look into our each other's eyes, every single one of us is worthy of loving and belonging. and that you are more than the transactions you create in your life. That same love, that same spirit that we celebrate on Pentecost, that wind of God that flows through you, that makes you fully alive in those rare moments where you're just laughing uncontrollably with friends at the dinner table. You know what I mean? Those laughs where you just can't control it and you get the giggles and your cheeks start to hurt and your tears shed, right? And then you start thinking about the inside jokes that you're going to share for years later. That kind of fully alive, that is the same kind of love that we are meant to express to people that are different than us. And it's only then, the more we do that, so that we're actually able to allow we to truly be greater than me. And friends, it's a hard thing. It's a difficult thing. All really good things in life always are. Let's pray. God, we give you thanks, first and foremost, for your gospel. The things you said, the things you did, the way you taught. You shook people's head. You turned up social norms. You challenged people to be differently. You challenged them and us to not be about ourselves, but to be a part of the greater good, of what we see God doing collectively with humanity throughout all of Scripture. So God, I pray in our own little way, in whatever capacities we have, I pray that you would help us to do that. You would help us to live into your community level of engagement, to your vision for us. I pray that we might dive deeper than we ever have before. That we're willing to take risks. We're willing to sacrifice. We're willing to bless those that have the incapacity to pay us back. That in doing so, we become our true selves. And we become our full selves as you created us to be. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Just a moment, if you're at home, I invite you to gather communion supplies. And if you're in the room, we're getting ready to take communion. And I'm reminded that for the first 1,500 years of the church, communion was the central aspect of the gathering. It was the reason people gathered was to take part in Holy Communion. And it wasn't until the Protestant Reformation that it shifted slightly, that the sermon became the central aspect of worship. So for the first 1,500 years, the table became the central. In fact, there's still churches today that the communion table is still the central aspect. And there's a strong movement for most denominations to bring that back as well. And we ask ourselves why. And the reason is because whenever we gather at this table, we really are reminded and living into, in some small way, the truth that we is greater than me. In the 18th century, when Methodist preachers would travel around America, slavery was in full steam. And they would go to plantations where slaves and owners would gather together at the same table. And it has been written by slaves themselves that even for just a small moment, and I would argue a small, incomplete moment, a flicker, a wisp, a tangible second, even the most vulnerable, the most ostracized in our society got to feel welcome in a real and authentic way on equal playing fields with those that had extraordinary power. And I think it can be true for us too, that even for just a moment, as we take part in that bread and that juice, just a moment we get a foretaste of the kingdom of God. That we come to this place on equal footing, that there's no one that's ever been on this side of the table and no one on that side of the table that has ever said that I've achieved perfection, I've made it, I am the end-all be-all. That we all are at the mercy of God. We're all in need of God's forgiveness and grace every single day. And communion is that place that is a tangible reminder for us. Someone hands you that bread and says, "Is the body of Christ broken for you?" Or maybe even just, "Jesus loves you." It is a tangible reality of God's infinite love for you, made real in the palm of your hand. When you dip it into the cup just about a third of the way and consume both elements at the same time, you are somehow drastically different. Your body's going to digest it. I know it sounds gross, especially in this pandemic era, right? But you are physically different when you leave because you take part in communion. And further, all of us took part in it together. And maybe it makes all the difference. So God, we ask you to pour out your Spirit upon this bread and this juice. May it be for us a real, tangible reminder of your infinite love and grace that knows no bounds, that knows no boundaries, and any divisions that we create are human-made and never by you. So God, as we come to this table, I pray that if we're in need of forgiveness, that you would offer it to us. If we're in need of an inspirational moment, that you would give that to us as well. If we're in need of just a moment of quiet rest, that you would allow us to have it. If you need us to be encouraged and challenged to reach out to somebody we hadn't before, I pray that you would help us to do it. And above all else, as we take part in this feast and just have a little glimpse of your kingdom, help us to treasure it and to take it with us. It's in your Son's holy name we pray. Amen. I'll invite our communion servers to come forward. We will have two stations, one in the middle aisle and one in the right aisle. If you have gluten-free restriction, or maybe you're just not in a place where you're ready to take part in communion with intinction, I would invite you to come down this middle aisle, and we have individual cups that can be made available to you. There's never too much hand sanitizer, I promise. The table is set. You may come just as you are.
At a time when the world seems to be spinning hopelessly out of control, there's deceivers and believers and known in between us that seem to have no place to go. It's the same old song, it's right and it's wrong, and love is just something that I do, and with no place to hide, I looked in your eyes, and I found myself in you. I look to the stars, drying all of the bones, and I'm nearly gone up in the smoke. And now my hands on the wheel of something that's real, and I feel like I'm going home. In the shade of an oak, down by the river, sit an old man and a boy, set and sail, spinning tales, fishing for whales with a lady that they both enjoy. It's the same old tune, it's the band.
stand and join me as we close today?
Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Melt me.
Thank you for joining us in worship today. I invite you to share in this benediction with me as it appears on the screen. Let us share in this together. As we leave this place, let us carry our love for you and each other into the world. Amen. Give them.